morning to everyone. Let me read to you Psalm 19, the perfect salvation of the Lord. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament shows his handiwork. Day unto day utters speech, and night unto night reveals knowledge. There is no speech nor language where their voice is not heard. Their line has gone out through all the earth, and their words to the ends of the world. In them he has set a tabernacle for the sun, which is like a bridegroom coming out of his chamber, and rejoices like a strong man to run its race. Its rising is from one end of heaven, and its circuit to the other end, and there is nothing hidden from its heat. The law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. The statutes of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. More to be desired are they than gold, yea, than much fine gold. Sweeter also than honey and the honeycomb. Moreover, by them your servant is warned, and in keeping them there is great reward. Who can understand his errors? Cleanse me from secret faults. Keep back your servants also from presumptuous sins. Let them not have dominion over me. Then I shall be blameless, and I shall be innocent of great transgression. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, we come to you with a grateful hearts, with a humble spirit. We bless your name, for you are holy, for you are great, you are mighty, you are awesome, Lord. And in your holiness, we see ourselves nothing before you. If there are some impurities, if there are some iniquities in our hearts, in our minds, in our thoughts, Lord, may you cleanse us with your righteousness, O Father. So, Father, may we lift up our hearts before you. May we sing songs from our hearts, O Father. And may we glorify your name alone. In the mighty name of Yehovah, we pray. Amen. Amen. Let us all stand up and let's praise and worship the Lord. Let's fill this place with our voices. Amen. Hallelujah.
Thee, O God, for the Son of Thy love, for Jesus who died and is now gone above. Hallelujah, Thine the glory, hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, Thine the glory, revive us again. Praise Thee, O God, for Thy Spirit of light, who has shown us our Savior and scattered our night. Hallelujah, Thine the glory, hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, Thine the glory, revive us again. All glory and praise to the Lamb that was slain, who hath borne all our sins and hath cleansed every stain. Hallelujah, Thine the glory, hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, earth and the glory, revive us again. Revive us again, fill each heart with thy love. May each soul be rekindled with fire from above. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Revive us again. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Revive us again. Praises rising, eyes are turning to you. We turn to you. Hope is stirring, hearts are yearning for you. We long. When we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna, you are the God who saves us. Worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna. Come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus. Hear the sound of hearts returning to you. We turn to you. In your kingdom, broken lives are made new. You make us new. 'Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna, you are the God who saves us. Worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna. Come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus. 'Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna, come have your way among us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna. Come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus.
Come on, sing.
Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna.
Let's pray together. Lord, thank you for giving us this time this morning to come before your throne, to be in your presence. Lord, I pray today that you're going to guide our understanding of all the things that we say and do, and that you're going to use it in a way that'll draw us not just closer to you, but in a way that'll help draw us closer to each other. And in all of it, Lord, we pray your will be done. And we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Good morning. Good to see you on this beautiful sunny day. Nice and warm outside. Thank you for taking the time to make this a part of your day and to be worshipful. You know, it doesn't matter what's going on in the world. It doesn't matter what's going on outside or anywhere else. God loves you. And by the way, happy Valentine's Day. And remember the love that God has for you. And I hope that's the love that brings you here today and the love that's going to keep you here today. We don't really have that many announcements. There are some things in the bulletin you may want to notice. But other than that, we just say welcome and thank you so much for taking the time to make this a part of your day. So let's stand together as we continue worship.
Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet. My Savior's on that cursed tree. His body Jesus,
This morning, as we come to our time of corporate prayer together, I want to draw a few names to your attention. We want to certainly continue to pray for Kevin Delaney. Kevin, you know, has been diagnosed with an inoperable cancer, and we want to be lifting him up. He also pulled his back this week, and so we want to be lifting him up for that. We want to remember Mary Sutherland. She's having surgery on her hand this week. Also, I want to continue to pray for Pat Ryan. Pat's struggling with coronavirus, also with leukemia. We also want to continue to pray for Vicki Rice today. Also, remember Dave and Mary Overstreet. They've both been down with COVID. They were both in the hospital. They're both home now, but they're recovering. We'll be remembering them. Also, the Daly family. This is a family that lost two members of their family in a very short time due to coronavirus. Want to continue to pray for Angie and Jim in their recovery. Want to be remembering Scott Rayom and his family. They've lost a loved one. They're traveling to be a part of that service. And certainly we always want to remember our country and our leaders and our military, our first responders, firefighters, police officers, all of those people that do their job so well each and every day. And there may be others for prayer this morning. Any special requests for prayer before we have our prayer time together? Yes, sir. Okay, Kelly. Amen. Okay. Amen. Chuck and Mark. Thank you, sir. Anyone else this morning? All right. Well, then let's have our prayer together. Lord, what a privilege, and I hope we count it as an honor, to be able to call ourselves the children of God and to know today without any question that you care about us. You're here with us. You're guiding us every step of the way, every step we take, every breath we take is guided by you. Lord, you know the number of our days, and you know what it is we need to get through each and every day. And I'm thankful today that you provide all of our needs according to your riches and glory, and just so thankful for all that that means for us as believers today, that we have such a great hope, a great strength. When the world is facing what they think is hopeless, we know that there is hope. And I'm thankful for the hope that you give us today through Jesus Christ. Lord, we continue to pray for Kevin today. We're going to lift him up to you in a special way. He and Claudia both. Lord, we understand that you can heal his disease. And we pray for his healing. We pray for your spirit to comfort him and to guide him through each step of the way. We think of Mary having surgery this week. We pray for those surgeons, all of the people that are going to be attending to her. Pray that you would guide that. We continue to pray for Pat today and pray for her strengthening and recovery. We pray the same for Vicki today. And Lord, we know that you're there with her. I just pray that she'll sense your presence today. We pray the same for Dave and Mary. We pray for their recovery and pray that you'll strengthen them each and every day. We continue to pray for Angie and Jim today and pray that you'll guide them as they go through their difficulties. Lord, we're thankful for all that you've already done in their life and pray that you'll continue to guide and bless them. Pray for Kelly today. We lift her up, Lord, and pray that you'll work in her life in a very special way. We're thankful to hear what you've done in Chuck's life today, and we pray that you'll continue to guide his recovery and healing. And the same for Mark this morning that's been mentioned. Lord, we think of Scott and his family as they travel and as they comfort each other in the loss of a loved one. And Lord, we're thankful that you give us a hope and a peace that passes all understanding. In fact, we pray the same for the Daly family, Lord. We know that you're there with them, and they've gone through a horrible loss in a short time. Lord, we pray that you'll strengthen them and guide them to a new understanding of your mercy and your grace. And Lord, we thank you today for our country. We pray for our country and for our leaders. We pray for all of those who are working so hard to keep us safe every day, our military, firefighters, first responders, police officers. Lord, we thank you for our healthcare workers, all of those people that you've given us to keep us safe each and every day. We pray that you'll bless them and strengthen them today in a special way. And then, Lord, there are so many things that are in our minds and in our lives that we didn't mention this morning, things that we're lifting up to you silently. Because we know today that you are not just our best hope, you're our only hope. And so, Lord, as we lift these things up to you, our main prayer is that in all things your will be done to your honor and glory. And we pray these things in the powerful name of Jesus Christ, and for his sake, amen. Amen. If you have your Bibles this morning, let's turn to John chapter 2. John chapter 2. You know, most of the time when we think about Jesus, we think about someone who's very meek and someone who's very mild. And I'm sure that's usually how Jesus was. But there are definitely times when you can see that Jesus was more than just a meek person. In fact, one of the greatest examples of his strength was the strength that it took for him to go up to the cross. And this morning we're going to look at a passage that usually in your Bible has the subtext of Jesus clearing the temple. And we're going to look at the background of the story to really understand how something like that could even happen in the first place. And the reason we're going to ask some questions is because there are folks who might say that what we're reading here in John proves that there's a discrepancy in the Gospels. In the first three Gospels, we call those the Synoptic Gospels. In the first three Gospels, the clearing of the temple is seen in the last week of Jesus' life. And here in John, we're reading it in the first part of the ministry of Jesus. And so some people have said, well, that must mean that the Bible is contradicting itself and you can't really trust the Bible. Now, there are any number of answers, I'm sure, that you could give people on that. But one possible answer is that the people who were writing the Gospels were not so hung up on the chronology of the events like we might be today. They weren't trying to write a history book. They were trying to share events that would tell you about the good news of Jesus Christ. And the goal was to make sure that you knew about the events that happened, but they may not have all been in chronological order. And another likely explanation, in fact, the simplest explanation would be that Jesus cleared a temple more than once in his life. In fact, maybe once toward the beginning of his ministry and apparently one at the end of his ministry. And if you study John's account and you compare it with the other Gospels, you'll see that the details in what we're going to read today are different from the other Gospels. And those people were no different than we are. We don't always learn our lessons the first time around. So we have to be reminded of things that we already know. And so in the last week of Jesus' life, he came back to the temple and reminded them of something that he had already taught them once before. But the fact that he did it twice is even more reason for us to pay attention to what happened here. So let's look together starting in verse 13 in John chapter 2. It says, when it was almost time for the Jewish Passover, Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple courts, he found people selling cattle, sheep, doves, others sitting at tables exchanging money. So he made a whip out of cords and he drove all from the temple courts, both sheep and cattle. He scattered the coins of the money changers, overturned their tables. To those who sold doves, he said, get these out of here. Stop turning my father's house into a market. His disciples remembered that it is written, zeal for your house will consume me. The Jews then responded to them, what sign can you give us to prove that you have authority to do all this? Jesus answered them, destroy this temple, and I will raise it up again in 3 days. They replied, it has taken 46 years to build the temple, and you're going to raise it up in 3 days. But the temple he had spoken of was his body. And after he was raised from the dead, his disciples recalled what he had said. And then they believed the scripture and the words that Jesus had spoken. Now, while he was in Jerusalem at the Passover festival, many people saw the signs he was performing and believed in his name. But Jesus would not entrust himself to them, for he knew all people. He did not need any testimony about mankind, for he knew what was in each person. Now, let's think about why Jesus got angry, because sometimes people get confused when we tell them that Jesus got angry. Because if Jesus can lose his temper, then that means that I can lose my temper too. And that may be true to a point. But it can be a problem if I start justifying all of the anger I have using Jesus as an example, because the anger that Jesus had in that temple is not the anger that I usually have, and we'll see that in a little bit. But it appears that Jesus was angry for a couple of reasons. First of all, what those merchants were doing in the temple was distracting people from actually worshiping. Now, every once in a while I'll get a call from a funeral home and they'll say, we have a family that doesn't have a minister. Would you be available to come do a funeral service? And I, you know, most of the time I do. And so 6 years ago, I got a call from the funeral home for that reason. And the gentleman that had died had been born in Africa. He was a true African. And he had been raised as a Muslim. And he had lived most of his 90 years, a lot of his 90 years as a Muslim. But at some point in his life, he had converted to Christianity. And so had his wife. And he and his wife had six children. And three of those children had converted to Christianity. But three of them were still Muslim. So there was actually, from the start, there was a little bit of a rift in the family about what kind of service to have for this gentleman. By the way, very well-respected dentist. He was a doctor, had been for many, many years, and very well-respected in his field. But in the end, they decided on the Christian funeral because, obviously, at the time of his death, he was a Christian. Now, this is actually one of those situations where I look back and after it was over and thought, you know, maybe I should have thought a little bit harder before I agreed to do this service or not. But I remember at the time thinking, well, if there are Muslims there, this is going to be an opportunity to share the gospel with unsaved people. And at a funeral, you have a great opportunity to do that, regardless of what kind of funeral it might be. And I was working with one of the daughters who was a Christian. And she was helping me, kind of guiding me along and helping get the service together. She's very nice. She was very helpful. But she was very clear. She said, now, there could be some issues at the service on the side of the Muslim family and friends. Well, it was a really big funeral. Again, as you can imagine, gentleman had lived 90 years, very well respected in his field, had six children, all of their friends and families and so forth and so on. And as we got started on the service, I noticed that all of the Muslim family and friends were standing outside of the room looking in. And I was told that the reason they did that is because for them it would have been an abomination to come and attend a Christian service. Now, that was no big deal. It was interesting, but it was not really a big deal for me. But here's the point. I'm not sure who these other people were. Now, these were not the Muslim people because they wouldn't even come in the room. But there was a group of people, 25, 30 people. When the service started, and of course you've all been to enough funerals to know what happens at most funerals, and you know, someone's playing music, the minister comes in, says a prayer, and we're off and running. So I had come in, I started speaking, and there was this group of people, it must have been 25 or 30 people, and they were just milling around in the room. And I mean, like imagine in here, 25, 30 people just kind of standing up, standing around, talking to each other. Hey, Tommy, how you doing? Man, it's good to see you. How did we think about that football game, Doug? You know, things like this. Just mulling around while the service was going on. It was the most distracting thing I've ever had to deal with. And I mean, you know, when you are a speaker on a regular basis, you get used to distractions. But most of the time, it's little children. And they're crying, or I remember in one service, there was a little boy literally running up and down the aisles nonstop for about 4 or 5 minutes till one of his aunts, by the grace of God, grabbed him and took him outside somewhere. I don't even know what happened then. But these people were just milling around, and at some point, I really started to feel sorry for the people who were there to grieve. I felt sorry for the people who were trying to focus on the service. It was disrespectful to the family. It was disrespectful to the friends that were there to grieve. And that's sort of what I picture when we read this account about Jesus in the temple. There were people who had gone to the temple with the intention of worshiping and drawing into the presence of God. And here are these merchants. They've got their booths all set up. They've got goats and sheep and cattle and birds and all kinds of things. And on top of that, you've got money changers for people who would come from other places to be able to pay the right amounts of money in the right currency. And so when Jesus got there, he saw all this distraction going on. It was like a three-ring circus. And he knew it was wrong because it was preventing genuinely worshipful people from being able to do what they came to do. And so Jesus got upset about that. But then a second thing that Jesus got upset about, beyond the circus atmosphere, is that those merchants were still gouging people in addition to that. They were providing a service that people needed, and they were taking advantage of those people. They were overcharging for the animals that they were selling, and the people that were exchanging money weren't giving the proper exchange rates. They were making money off of it too. So it wasn't just what they were doing, which was very distracting. It's also how they were doing it. They were doing it in a way. They were taking the glory of God, throwing it aside, so that they could make a few bucks. And those merchants were doing something that was in a direct insult to the character of God and the will of God for that place. And Jesus got angry. Now, when Jesus got angry, I want you to notice a few things about Jesus' anger. First of all, Jesus' anger was restrained. I want you to understand something. Jesus did not just lose his temper. This was not just an impulsive act. And the reason I would say that is because it says he took time to make a whip out of cords. Now, I don't know how long it would have taken for him to make that whip out of cords, but he saw what was going on and he took the time to make that whip. If it were just an impulsive type of anger, Jesus would have walked into that temple and just said, "Hey, you're not supposed to be doing that." And just if he wanted to throw things or holler or whatever it was he wanted to do, it wasn't an impulsive anger. It was something that was very restrained. But also notice that Jesus' anger wasn't selfish. This wasn't about Jesus. Jesus was upset on behalf of God. Most of the time when we get angry, it's because of something dealing with our own ego. Somewhere we've been offended in some way. We're the opposite of Jesus. And it's so sad to say this. We're the opposite of Jesus. We tend to just shrug things off when people say things against the character and the will of God, but then get really upset when they say something about us that offends us. And we like to talk about righteous anger. That's, what our key phrase is as believers when we get angry. But righteous anger is an anger that's directed against something that's wrong, but you're angry for the right reason, which would be something that's going against a clear standard of the teaching of Scripture. The problem is, we want to believe that our anger is always righteous, and it almost never is. We just get upset, and as believers, we know we shouldn't be that upset, and so we try to spiritualize it and go, "Well, I have a righteous anger." But righteous anger is when you get angry about the things that make God angry. It's when we're passionate about the evils against God, not about something that's being done against us. There are other passages in the Bible that talk about anger. In Ephesians chapter 4, verses 26 and 27, the Bible says, "In your anger, do not sin. Do not let the sun go down while you are still angry, and do not give the devil a foothold." Or maybe in your version, it says, "Do not," or "Be angry and do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger." It just helps you know that sinful anger is a kind of anger that the sun is definitely going to set on. And it's the kind of anger that you're going to play in your head over and over again. And you're not going to be able to get sleep. In fact, some people will carry that kind of anger for the rest of their lives. And in Ephesians, Paul's saying, when you do that, you're giving the devil an opportunity to have control over your life through that anger. But another passage would be in James chapter 1, verses 19 and 20, which says, "Be quick to hear, slow to speak, slow to anger, for the anger of man does not produce the righteousness of God." And over time, the secular sciences have caught up to that. Psychology and sociology, they understand. A lot of times, our natural responses aren't just wrong, they're destructive. And as believers, when we start feeling that kind of thing coming up in us, we ought to be able to take a moment and step back and think and pray about what we're saying when we're upset. And I think if we do that, we get closer to the kind of response that God would want us to have. But I think a really interesting question, anytime we read about Jesus clearing the temple, is would Jesus be angry if he walked into church today? Now, this is actually a passage that's been used over the years to try and make a point that you shouldn't have fundraisers and things like that. I'm not so sure that's what's being said in this passage. In fact, I think the bigger message here is something that we ended with last week. We have to keep the proper focus on what we're doing here. We should be here to worship God in a way that's reverent and in a way that's God-focused. If we spend more time thinking about how to get people to give more money or how to grow a bigger church, we lose sight of what worship is all about. There's a passage in 2 Kings 23. It took place during the time of King Josiah. They were doing some remodeling work on the temple, and they found a book of the covenant, which is what we would probably know today as Deuteronomy. And Josiah started reading the book of the covenant, and he started looking at what was going on in the temple, and he realized how far they had gotten away from the things that God had wanted them to do. There were pagan symbols, there were idols, there were cult prostitutes, all sorts of horrible things going on in the temple. And I would read a passage like that, and we'd say, well, obviously our church isn't doing that bad. But when a church starts to focus on things like money, the temptation is to manipulate people to give more. If we're not seeing the numbers in worship that we think we ought to be having, we start trying to figure out, maybe we need to be more entertaining, and we work more on performance than we do on actually worshiping. There are churches out there that are very political. They're more focused on lobbying for a candidate or a political party than they are preaching the gospel. I want you to understand something. I'm not here to help you understand a political agenda better. We're here today to focus on Jesus Christ and how we ought to be living our lives in light of what he's done on that cross. So I would say that if Jesus showed up at any church that had lost its focus and was letting the things of the world drive the business of the church, yeah, he might get that whip out. So when Jesus cleared the temple, the religious leaders got upset. Jesus was upsetting the status quo. Now, you've probably studied over the years in your own study. There are people that have said that it's very likely that these religious leaders were getting some kind of a kickback from those merchants that were out there changing money and selling all those animals. And so they had a good thing going on, and here's Jesus. He's messing it up. So look how the people responded in verses 18 and 19 that we read. They said, "What sign can you show us to prove your authority to do all this?" Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple. I will raise it again in 3 days." They demanded for Jesus to show them a sign. Give us a sign to tell us that you have the authority to do what you're doing. And of course, Jesus did give them a sign, but it went much deeper than most of them could understand. He said, "Destroy this temple and I'll raise it back up again in 3 days." And of course, it explains here that he was talking about himself, but he said it in a language that would cause the faithful people to have to think more deeply and make his enemies think in the wrong direction. And it worked just like a charm because the leaders thought his claim was ridiculous. But it says here that Jesus' disciples remembered what Jesus said on that day after the resurrection. And it was a confirmation to them that that prophecy had been fulfilled, that Jesus had in fact raised that temple up. Now there is actually a benefit of the response of those people when they say, "Give us a sign." And Jesus said, "Well, tear down this temple and I'll raise it up in 3 days." They said, "What are you talking about? It's taken 46 years to build this temple." And that ignorance actually helps us out a little bit because scholars know that the construction of the temple started around 20 BC. So if it took 46 years, simple math, you're now up to 26, 27 AD. And that would be consistent with the other dates that we have in the Bible. So in one sense, God used the ignorance of those people to help us actually prove the accuracy of the Word of God. But Jesus was pointing them toward the greatest sign that they would ever see. He was pointing them toward the resurrection. That's the one miracle that would show without any hesitation that Jesus really was who, in fact, he said he was. The resurrection is what became the cornerstone of the Christian faith in Jesus. And I've said this many times, but without the resurrection, the rest of Jesus' ministry really wouldn't have mattered. The resurrection is what proves that all of Jesus' ministry was genuinely from God, and that Jesus was actually the one and only Son of God. And we need to understand that, because there are plenty of folks out there who are fine with religion, but they don't want to understand that God actually became a man and lived among us. And so they're so wrapped up in their own life and what they're doing that they get upset when God won't conform to their plans. Well, look what happened in verses 24 and 25. It says that many people saw the signs he was performing and believed in his name, but Jesus would not entrust himself to them, for he knew all people. He did not need any testimony about mankind, for he knew what was in each person. Even though there were people who believed in Jesus, Jesus understood there are always going to be people out there who are just looking for the latest, greatest gimmick. So it says here, he didn't entrust himself to those people. He understood that a lot of times what people want to call faith is actually very superficial, very temporary. When we talk about faith, faith is actually something that God produces in us through the work of the Holy Spirit. In fact, we know from Scripture that's why Jesus taught in parables. The true believers would take the things that Jesus taught and they would look for the meaning in them. And the superficial folks would just walk away and say, well, that guy doesn't make any sense. That's why as believers, we need to listen and learn from what Jesus says, because he's teaching us about who we are and about why we do the things that we do. And if we'll listen to what he has to say, we can grow in the faith. The thing that holds up a lot of people is, as human beings, we want to define the truth by what we want it to be. And then we take that defined truth of our own and we make our preferences the laws for ourselves and for everybody else around us. But then we expand that to God. We want God to adopt our values, even if those values are the exact opposite of what God says in his word. And that not only prevents us from growing in our faith, that's what makes us superficial believers. In fact, that makes us no different than the religious leaders in Jesus' day. You can be very religious and still be completely off base. And next week, we're going to look at what it really means to be a child of God. But for today, there are a few things I want us to take away from this passage. First, I want you to see that Jesus was passionate about worship, and we should be too. Listen, whenever we come into this place, one thing I don't want you to ever forget is that worship is supposed to honor God. We're here to praise God. We're here to see what God will say to us through his word and then adjust our lives, get our lives in line to live with that word. Genuine worship is not supposed to be consumer driven. In other words, we're not just here doing things, trying to draw as many people in here as we can. It doesn't matter whether or not you leave here feeling good or not. It's designed to bring people into the presence of God. Genuine worship is God-driven. It's not about what I get out of worship. It's what I'm bringing to the Lord in worship that matters. And that's why we always have to check our motives. Make sure we're not drifting away. Back to 2 Kings 23. That we're not drifting away from God. Or just as bad, just going through the motions. It's very easy to be religious. If someone wants to be a religious person, it's not difficult to be a religious person. It's not difficult to sit in a building for an hour and feel like, well, if I drop dead, I'm on God's good side and I've done my duty. But genuine worship is something that's going to engage your heart, and it's going to engage your soul and your mind. And it's going to lead you to an encounter with God that ultimately will change your life forever. But another thing I want you to see here is that Jesus' anger was different from our anger. If we're completely honest with ourselves, the anger that we have is almost exclusively built around us more than it is anything else. Listen, no one should ever use Jesus in the temple to justify their anger. Anger is an emotion. It's going to happen to all of us, well, you know, for whatever reason. But if you're a believer, at some point, the Holy Spirit is going to replace that anger with forgiveness and patience and understanding and humility and love. We need to learn to repent of our anger, not spend time justifying our anger. We're living in, I think, an angry world. In fact, if you stand in line, sometimes you feel like the only people getting things done are the angry people. But God wants us to work to be more and more like Jesus. That's one of the main things that separate believers from the rest of the world. And when we do that, we do it because we know there's power that comes from living a godly life. But then one final thing I want you to understand is that the resurrection of Jesus is the only evidence we need to prove the gospel message. You know, God doesn't have to prove anything to us. We have been given all the evidence that we need. The resurrection of Jesus, it's not just something we're going to celebrate in April. The resurrection of Jesus is the anchor of our souls. The resurrection of Jesus is what reminds us that Jesus was actually God in human form. The resurrection is the evidence that when we die, there's more than what we're seeing in this world. And it's because of the resurrection that we can have that passion in worship. This resurrection, the resurrection isn't any kind of a small thing. It's the most important event ever. As believers, we've been saved by a sacrifice that God made on that cross. We've been set free to worship a God who's done everything that we need to be right with Him. You know, there's nothing greater than that. If you stop and really let that just wash over you, and understand it in as full a sense as you're able to, as the Holy Spirit directs you, you'll understand it is the greatest gift you've ever been given. That grace of God through Jesus Christ and the fact that He died and rose again. It's just such a blessing today to take away the fears that we have and the hopelessness that we see. We don't have to have that fear. We don't have to have that hopelessness. Because we have the grace of God. We have the love of God through Jesus Christ. And for any person within the sound of my voice that's never accepted Christ as their Lord and Savior, today would be the day to do that. In fact, in just a moment, we're going to sing an invitation hymn. And I would hope that today would be the day that anybody on the fence would get off of that fence and allow God to work in their heart in a special way. We're actually going to sing a song, I Surrender All. That's what it takes to surrender every part of your life, every area of your life. You're not holding anything back. You're not saying, I'm surrendering 10% or 50% or 99%. I'm surrendering everything. I'm surrendering 100% of what I am to Jesus, understanding that God can take it and use my life in a special way. If you need to make that decision, do it today. God may lead you to make other decisions, whatever they may be. Don't leave here today without responding to the call God gives you. Let's stand together as we sing. Listen, I appreciate you being here today. I know there are people watching online. There are people out in the parking lot. And those of you that are here in the building, I appreciate everybody that's taking the time to make this a part of your day. It means a lot. And I want you to understand that God loves you. That's so important. I love you. But it's so much more important for you to understand that God loves you. No matter what you're going through right now, He will not leave you. He will not forsake you. And I want you to know that in a powerful way. Listen, I hope you have a great day. Let's close with a word of prayer. Lord, we thank you again for the blessing of having been here today. And knowing that you love us. And knowing that you never leave us or forsake us. Lord, I pray that you'll guide us through this day and every day. As we recommit ourselves to your service. And pray that your will be done in all things. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
glory. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Revive us again.
God bless everyone.
We praise thee, O God, for thy spirit.